Rahul, do you want to read the seven realities if it's visible to you?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it is.
Okay, Jai Baba.
Yeah.
Everybody,
seven realities.
Please, yeah.
Just a minute.
Yeah. Go ahead.
The seven realities. Yeah. The seven realities: existence, love, sacrifice, renunciation, knowledge, control, and surrender. I give no importance to creed, dogma, caste, or to the performance of religion ceremonies and rites, but to the understanding of the following seven realities. Number one, the only real existence is that of the one and only God, who is the self in every finite self. Two, the only real love is a love for this infinity God, which arouses an intense longing to see, know, and become one with its truth, God. The only real sacrifice is what is that in which, in pursuance of this love, all things, body, mind, position, welfare, and even life itself are sacrificed. Number four, the real renunciation is that which abandons, even in the midst of worldly duties, all selfish thoughts and desires. Number five, the only real knowledge is the knowledge of, the only real knowledge is the knowledge that God is the
inner dweller
in good people and in so-called bad, in saint and in so-called sinner. This knowledge requires you to help all equally as circumstances demand, without expectation of reward. When compelled to take part in a dispute, to act without the slightest trace of enmity or hatred, to try to make others happy with brotherly or sisterly feelings for each one, and to harm no one in thought, word, or deed, not even those who harm you. Number six, the real control is the discipline of the senses to abstain from indulgence in low desires, which alone ensures absolute purity of character. Number seven, the only real surrender is that in which the poise is undisturbed by any adverse circumstance, and the individual amidst every kind of hardship is resigned with perfect calm, the will of God. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba. Jai Baba. Thank you. So we are now down to the part eight. Two parts or two types of meditation get treatment as a full part by Baba. One is Nirvikalpa Samadhi, and the second is Sahaja Samadhi. So there was a reference to Sahaja Avastha, and now we are going into Sahaja Samadhi in detail. We had a question as well on Sahaja Avastha. I think we didn't get to it, if I remember. So I think let's see if we unravel more about Sahaja Samadhi in this part, right? Also, we have the extended class today. I request, there is a extended session today where Vidya will walk through her template and take questions and make that a more practical, usable guide in our hands. I'm looking forward to that. That is after 1 hour of reading. So part eight, Sahaja Samadhi, culmination of meditation. I'll just increase the font size before we proceed. When the mind totally merges in the truth, it experiences the nirvikalpa state of spontaneous bliss of uninterrupted self-knowledge, in which the aspirant loses his limited individuality to discover that he is identical with God, who is in everything. By the grace of a perfect master, the nirvikalpa state becomes the culmination of the earlier forms of personal and impersonal meditation and not their product. All forms of meditation followed by the aspirant as well as his other spiritual efforts, in spite of their differences, have only one aim, namely to speed up the fruition of his longing to be united with the infinite. Nirvikalpa Samadhi experienced after union. When this union is effected, the sadhak, the aspirant, becomes a siddha, one who has attained the goal. The union with the infinite that the siddha achieves is referred to by the Sufis as vasal. It is the state of union with God that is described by Jesus Christ in the words, I and my Father are one. Many have written about this high state of consciousness, but it remains essentially indescribable. It cannot be expressed in words, and therefore it cannot be adequately explained. Though it can never be explained one by one person to another, it can be experienced by one for oneself. This nirvikalpa state, when experienced by the siddha, is nirvikalpa samadhi, body state. To dwell in nirvikalpa samadhi is to experience the God state in which the soul knows itself to be God, because it has shed all the limiting factors that had hitherto contributed towards false self-knowledge. The God state of the Siddha stands out in clear contrast with the body state of the worldly. The worldly individual takes himself to be the body and dwells in a state dominated by the body and its wants. His consciousness centers on the body. He is concerned with eating, drinking, sleeping, and the satisfaction of other bodily desires. It is for the body that he lives and seeks fulfillment. His consciousness cannot extend beyond the body. He thinks in terms of the body and cannot conceive of anything that has no body or form. The entire sphere of his existence is comprised of forms, and the theater in which he lives and moves and has his being consists of space. Energy state. The first step toward the God state of nirvikalpa samadhi is taken when the body state is transcended. Shedding the body state means entering the sphere of existence comprised of energy. The soul then dwells in a state that is no longer dominated by forms or bodies. It is lifted up to the domain of energy. Body or form is a solidification of energy, and to rise from the world of forms to the sphere of energy amounts to an advance toward a more primary and purer state of being. The energy state is free from many of the limitations that obtain in the world of forms. In this state, consciousness is linked with energy and continuously vibrates in and through energy. In the energy state, the eating and drinking of the body state are paralleled by the absorption and assimilation of energy. At this level, the soul acquires full control over energy and seeks fulfillment through its use. But its actions are still within the domain of spiritual limitation. It can see, hear, and smell many things that are inaccessible in the body state and can perform many feats. For example, producing light in the dark, or living for innumerable years only on energy, which seem to be miracles for those who are in the body state. The entire sphere of the soul's existence is comprised of energy and is dominated by energy. All that it can conceive of or do is in terms of energy and is achieved by means of energy. The energy state is the state of spiritually advanced souls, but it is far from being the state of perfection which expresses itself through the nirvikalpa samadhi of the siddha. Mind state. The second important step towards nirvikalpa samadhi is taken when the soul transcends the domain of energy and enters the domain of the mind. All energy is ultimately an expression of the mind. Therefore, the transition from the energy state to the mind state constitutes a still further advance toward the God state of nirvikalpa samadhi. In the mind state, consciousness is directly linked with the mind. It is in no way fettered by the domination of the body or energy, but it is mind-ridden. Advanced souls who are in the mind state can read and influence the mind of others. However, the mind-ridden state is still within the domain of duality and illusion, and it has to be transcended before the attainment of union with the infinite. Mind veils the truth. The entire advance from the very beginning consists in gradually curtailing and transcending the working of the individual mind. The mind is functioning even in the body state and in the energy state. In the body state, the mind thinks in terms of the body. In the energy state, it thinks in terms of energy, while in the mind state, it thinks in its own terms. However, even when the mind thinks in its own terms, it does not attain knowledge and realization of the infinite because it becomes its own veil between thought and truth. Though the mind may be unencumbered by life in the body state or the energy state, it is still limited by separative consciousness. It might be compared to a mirror that is covered with dust. The mind has therefore to be completely merged and dissolved in the infinite before it is possible to experience the God state of Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Form is solidified energy. Energy is an expression of mind. Mind is the covered mirror of eternity, and eternity is truth that has thrown off the mask of the mind. Transcending mind. To discard the limiting mind is no easy thing. The chief difficulty is that the mind has to be annihilated through the mind itself. Intense longing for union with the infinite reality, as well as infinite patience, are indispensable in the process of transcending the mind. One master told his disciple that in order to attain the highest state, he had to be thrown, bound hand and foot to a plank, into a river where he must keep his garments dry. The disciple could not understand the inner meaning of this injunction. He wandered until he encountered another master and asked him the meaning of the injunction. The master explained that in order to attain God, he had to long intensely for union with him, as if he could not live another moment without it. And yet, to have the inexhaustible patience that could wait for billions of years. If there is lack of intense longing for union with God, the mind lapses into its usual sanskaric working. And if there is lack of infinite patience, the very longing that the mind entertains sustains the working of the limited mind. It is only when there is a balance between infinite longing and infinite patience that the aspirant can ever hope to pierce through the veil of the limited mind, and the combination of extremes can only come through the grace of a perfect master. God state of Nirvikalpa Samadhi. To dwell in Nirvikalpa Samadhi is to dwell in truth consciousness. This God state cannot be grasped by anyone whose mind is still working. It is beyond the mind, for it dawns when the limited mind disappears in final union with the infinite. The soul then knows itself through itself and not through the mind. The worldly individual knows that he is a human being and not a dog. In the same way, in Nirvikalpa Samadhi, the soul just knows that it is God and not a finite thing. The worldly person does not have to keep repeating to himself that he is not a dog, but a human being. He just knows without having to make any special effort that he is a human being. In the same way, the soul in Nirvikalpa Samadhi does not need any artificial inducing of God consciousness through repeated auto-suggestions. It just knows itself to be God through effortless intuition. Life in eternity. One who experiences Nirvikalpa Samadhi is established in the knowledge of the soul. This self-knowledge does not come and go. It is permanent. In the state of ignorance, the individual soul looks upon itself as a man or woman, as the agent of limited actions and the receiver of joys and pains. In the state of self-knowledge, it knows itself as the soul, which is not in any way limited by these things and is untouched by them. Once it knows its own true nature, it has this knowledge forever and never again becomes involved in ignorance. The state of God consciousness is infinite and is characterized by unlimited understanding, purity, love, and happiness. To be in Nirvikalpa Samadhi, which for the rare few leads to Sahaja Samadhi, is the endlessness of life in eternity. Sahaja Samadhi, or divinity in action, is experienced by the Sadgurus and is preceded by two states, Nirvana, or absorption in divinity, and Nirvikalpa Samadhi, or divinity in expression. two states precede Sahaj Samadhi is what the heading is. When consciousness is withdrawn entirely from all the bodies and the world of creation, it leads to Nirvana or the beyond mind state. But when consciousness again functions through the bodies without attachment or identification, it experiences Nirvikalpa Samadhi of the Siddha. Here, though consciousness is attached to the bodies as instruments, it is detached from them inwardly by non-identification. The piercing of the mind amounts to the complete withdrawal of consciousness from the universe to its total absorption in God. This is the state where the universe becomes a zero. This is Nirvana. After Nirvana, those who become conscious of the universe experience it as nothing but God and nothing but God and remain constantly in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Nirvikalpa Samadhi means a life where the mental activity of false imagination has come to an end and the oscillations of the limited mind are all stilled in the realization of the unchangeable truth. So if you want, I will pause here. There's quite a bit of series of concepts that we have raced through in this chapter. So if I just go back, first is the Nirvikalpa Samadhi, culmination of meditation, then the body state. From the body state, you go to the pure energy state, and then you go to the mind state, and then Baba says mind veils the truth, and you transcend the mind, and then you go to the God state of Nirvikalpa Samadhi, and life in eternity is basically where the Nirvikalpa Samadhi is in recognition of timelessness, right? So here, there is a very, very important line. So he describes the three things clearly, and I think it's for us to discuss and understand this more clearly. Sahaja Samadhi or divinity in action is experienced by the Sadguru and is preceded by two states. Nirvana, he says, is absorption in divinity, and Nirvikalpa Samadhi is divinity in expression. And I think I need some help here. Anybody who can jump in and throw some weight on this before we go further, it will be a better absorption of the whole thing, right? Anybody?
Kama yeah. has been explaining it repeatedly. He can do it once again.
Sure.
Jai Baba, what I've understood is basically the goal is God realization. Now, based on God speaks, so again, I'm re-emphasizing, please use God Speaks as your foundation platform, because there are some terminologies and discourses which are a little bit different or not fully explained as in God Speaks. For example, Moksha, Nirvana, Nirvikalpa Samadhi, Sahaja Samadhi. So based on God Speaks, Moksha or ordinary Mukti is after you drop the body, after 3 or 4 days, one gets moksha, which is you will be in bliss, no more samsara. Nirvana, Nirvikalpa Samadhi, Sahaja Samadhi happens in body form. Every individual soul has to have fana or nirvana,
audio,
which is defined as absorption in divinity. And a few of the people who transcend, that is the first state of fana, nirvana. Second state of fana is fana phila, nirvikalpa samadhi, where God realization or self-realization implies satchitananda. So the confusion out here, it keeps saying self-knowledge. It should be infinite knowledge, infinite power, and infinite bliss. Now, few from the, in the nirvikalpa samadhi state, according to God Speaks, most would drop the body after 3 or 4 days, but some, based on prarabdha karma or like the divine will stay in the madhub state, or as I said, jivan mukta paramahamsa. And a few of them basically will the about five of them will become perfect masters. Now I would ask you to refer to page 278 in God Speaks. There is that table, you know, you should take it and paste it like along with this table on the types of meditation, general meditation and specialized forms of meditation. These three, I think you got to look every day and slowly it will seep in. So again, in summary, absorption in divinity is nirvana because there is only the divine vacuum state, which is the original state of God, which in the final state, you are able to consciously experience the divine vacuum state. And Nirvikalpa Samadhi is divinity in expression because the God realized soul is, if he retains the body for 30, 40 years, he is in God consciousness state. He doesn't come down to creation consciousness. So Sahaja Samadhi is divinity in action, where the God realized soul is simultaneously or alternatively in God consciousness as well as comes down to gross consciousness. So this is what in page 278 you realize that there's a clear demarcation between, I will tell you, a Jivan Mukta, Sahaja Samadhi with the consciousness of Tribhuvan, and Sahaja Samadhi for a Sadguru or Kutub is Sahaja Samadhi or Atma Pratishtapana with the duty of Tribhuvan. I think this word Atma Pratishtapana is only in God Speaks. It's not been referred to in discourses. So there are only three states: absorption in divinity, which is Nirvana. These are all definitions. Nirvikalpa Samadhi, divinity in expression, D-I-E. And Sahaja Samadhi, divinity in action, D-I-A. So those are the three main differences. And these three happens before the body is dropped. But moksha, ordinary mukti, happens after the body is dropped, according to God Speaks. I hope I made sense. Jai Baba.
Yeah, this is the reference that Kama was making. The chart next to page 278 on God Speaks. Thanks. I think that clarifies. I think so. Sahaja Samadhi is where you where it is divinity in action, only experienced by a Sadguru.
No, it is. See, that's what I thought initially. But according to the table 278. Even the Jivan Mukta, like Ramana Maharishi, also is in the Sahaja Samadhi state. But if you take Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, he was in the Nirvikalpa Samadhi alternatively with or without the consciousness of Tribhuvan. Now, Tribhuvan, let me tell you, is state 2C, okay, Vijnan Bhumi. So state 2C is the God realized soul in human form, who has not dropped the body and helping is basically in divinity in action, Sahaja Samadhi. So that is why I think even Paramahamsa also, because Paramahamsa is defined as Nirvikalpa Samadhi, but he alternates between God consciousness and creation consciousness, which is basically conscious of the gross body, subtle body, mental body, and also the gross spheres, gross, subtle, and mental spheres of existence. So it's a little bit of a, puzzle. You have to, kind of read through it again and again, and it will make sense later. Hey, Bob.
Correct. Okay. So I stopped at this paragraph, so I'll continue.
Karthik, I have one question which anybody could answer. On this chapter, Types of Meditation, which you just read, second paragraph, page number 246. Okay. And probably, Vidya, if after anybody can comment on that later after 8:30 when Vidya is going through that, if she's also able to comment, that will be great. Where it says that, It is the state of union with God that is described by Jesus Christ in the words, I and my Father are one. Many have written about this high state of consciousness, but it remains essentially indescribable. It cannot be expressed in words, and therefore it cannot be adequately explained. Though it can never be explained by one person to another, it can be experienced by one for oneself. So my question here is, if you remember reading God Speaks in the 10 states of God, we don't have to do it today, but if you could refer to it and probably tomorrow we can discuss. There is, when we are discussing the state one of God and state two of God, which is state one is beyond God's state and state two is beyond God's state of God. There is a mention that the first state is indescribable, but the second state is what is described as Paramatma and Nirvikalpa Samadhi. So I wanted to kind of clarify on this particular paragraph how to interpret it. Jai Baba.
Sure. So anybody wants to comment on that right now? We can discuss that.
Yeah, sure. I just have one question. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead, Ashok.
Tribhuvan is a word which we heard. So can that be elaborated? Because Tribhuvan is not clear.
Yeah, so if you see God
speaking, I think that's this.
Yeah, go ahead.
I think this is refers to the three world, gross world, subtle world, and mind. That is the three worlds. That is the one to me.
Good. Thank you.
Okay.
Before that, can we put in three words Nirvikalpa as absorption? Nirvana as absorption, Nirvikalpa as expression. And Sahaja Samadhi as action.
Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah.
Very simple, Professor. Correct. Yeah.
Perfect.
Hey, Baba.
So, we'll start with Moksha, Nirvana, and Nirvikalpa. Continue from there. Nirvana and Nirvikalpa are similar to the state of Moksha, liberation, but only in representing the merging of the individual soul in God. And in yielding eternal bliss. Moksha is experienced after the soul has dropped its bodies. Can all of you go on mute, please? While the states of Nirvana and Nirvikalpa can both be experienced before giving up the bodies. However, though the states of Nirvana and Nirvikalpa are similar as to retaining the bodies, and though they are also fundamentally the same in essence, there is a difference between the two. When the soul comes out of the ego shell and enters into the infinite life of God, its limited individuality is replaced by unlimited individuality. As the limitations of the individuality are entirely extinguished, the soul knows that it is God conscious and thus preserves its unlimited individuality. Though the unlimited individuality of the soul is in a way retained in the union with the infinite, it nevertheless remains quiescent and absorbed in the experience of self-contained divinity that is in the state of Nirvana. But when the soul, having entered the infinite life of God, establishes its unlimited individuality through the release of dynamic divinity, it is in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Sahaja Samadhi, states of Sadgurus and the Avatar. Sahaja Samadhi comes to very few souls who descend from the seventh plane of consciousness as Sadgurus, while it is the very life of the avatar. The poise and harmony of this state remain undisturbed even while giving energetic response to the changing circumstances of life. Those who are in this state live the life of God and experience God everywhere and in everything. Their God state is therefore in no way diminished when dealing with the things of this world. Whether drawing a bow or using a sword in the battlefield, whether flying in an aeroplane or talking to people, or whether engaged in other activities that may require the closest attention, they are continuously in the state of conscious enjoyment of the immutable truth. Such is Sahaja Samadhi, the effortless and continuous life of perfection and divinity in action. So I think with that we come to the end of meditation. Any other questions and discussions before we continue? We go to part 6 now. Start with God and the individual. So I think we exhausted all the questions. Good.
To be learned through experience.
Yes.
So, okay. Jai Baba.
That Namita is doing tomorrow, right?
So it's page 32.
Oh, okay. One second. I thought you said 6. Yeah. You said 6 in your Excel. Okay. Okay. 32. Formation and function of samskaras. Kama, if you go to your Excel reference, you put 6, 7, then 8, 9. Is this the way you want it? God and the individual, beginning and the end of creation, then formation of samskaras, right? Kama, you're on.
Another mute. Point, sorry, yeah, the late comment. Another point which was very appealing and very attacking was the intense longing. The intense longing part, which Baba has emphasized in the form of love. So,
correct.
That's very important. And that's the main aim, to develop love. And that's what Baba keeps saying, love me. And I take care of you. Yeah, Baba. I take care of the rest. Your job is to love me and rest is my business.
Yeah, he also used an illustrative story. Yes.
Yeah. So, intense longing is a very strong statement there.
Thank you. Kama.
Yeah, formation and function of sanskaras, according to your format, it's chapter 8, right? 5+3, 8, page
10. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. I'm saying you in your Excel, that your reading sequence on the right side, you put 6, 7, then 8. So I just want to check again, that's all.
Yeah.
God and the individual, can you see that?
No, this is it. Just stick
to this. Okay, yeah. All right, cool. Page 32 on the physical book, the formation and function of samskaras. Analysis of human experience. There are two aspects of human experience, the subjective and objective. On the one hand, there are mental processes that constitute essential ingredients of human experience. And on the other hand, there are things and objects to which they refer. The mental processes are partly dependent upon the immediately given objective situation and partly dependent upon the functioning of accumulated samskaras or impressions of previous experiences. The human mind thus finds itself between a sea of past samskaras on the one side and the whole extensive objective world on the other. Samskaras originate in experience. Human actions are based upon the operation of the impressions stored in the mind through previous experiences. Every thought, emotion, and act is grounded in groups of impressions that, when considered objectively, are seen to be modifications of the mind. These impressions are deposits of previous experiences and become the most important factors in determining the course of present and future experience. The mind is constantly creating and gathering such impressions in the course of its experience. When occupied with the physical objects of this world, such as the body, nature, and other things, the mind is, so to say, externalized and creates gross impressions. When it is busy with its own subjective mental processes, which are the expressions of already existing samskaras, it creates subtle and mental impressions. The question whether samskaras come first or experience comes first is like the question whether the hen or the egg comes first. Both are conditions of each other and develop side by side. The problem of understanding the significance of human experience therefore turns around the problem of understanding the formation and function of samskaras. Samskaras are of two types, natural and non-natural, according to the manner in which they come into existence. The samskaras the soul gathers during the period of organic evolution are natural. These samskaras come into existence as the soul successively takes up and abandons the various subhuman forms, thus gradually passing from the apparently inanimate states, such as stone or metal, to the human state, where there is full development of consciousness. All the samskaras that cluster around the soul before it attains the human form are the product of natural evolution and are referred to as natural samskaras. They should be carefully distinguished from the samskaras cultivated by the soul after attainment of the human form. The samskaras that get attached to the soul during the human stage are cultivated under the moral freedom of consciousness, with its accompanying responsibility of choice between good and bad, virtue and vice. They are referred to as non-natural samskaras. Though these post-human samskaras are directly dependent upon the natural, they are created under fundamentally different conditions of life and are in their origin comparatively more recent than the natural samskaras. This difference in the length of the formative periods and in the conditions of formation is responsible for the difference in the degree of firmness of attachment of the natural and non-natural samskaras to the soul. The non-natural samskaras are not as difficult to eradicate as the natural, which have an ancient heritage and therefore more firmly rooted. The obliteration of the natural samskaras is practically impossible unless the neophyte is the recipient of the grace and the intervention of a Sadguru or perfect master. The non-natural samskaras are dependent upon the natural, and the natural samskaras are a result of evolution. The next important question is, why should manifested life in different stages of evolution emerge out of the absolute reality, which is infinite? Manifested life arises out of the will to be conscious in absolute. That's the subtitle. The need for manifested life arrives out of the impetus in the absolute to become conscious of itself. The progressive manifestation of life through evolution is ultimately brought about by the will to be conscious, which is inherent in the infinite. In order to understand creation in terms of thought, it is necessary to posit this will to be conscious in the absolute in a latent state prior to the act of manifestation. Lahar with absolute compared to a wave on the ocean. Although, for purposes of an intellectual explanation of creation, the impetus in the absolute has to be regarded as a will to be conscious, to describe it as a sort of inherent desire is to falsify its true nature. It's better described as a lahar or an impulse, which is so inexplicable, spontaneous, and sudden that to call it this or that is to have its reality undone. As all intellectual categories necessarily turn out to be inadequate for grasping the mystery of creation, the nearest approach to understanding its nature is not through intellectual concept, but through analogy. Just as a wave going across the surface of a still ocean calls forth into being a wild stir of innumerable bubbles, the lahar creates myriads of individual souls out of the indivisible infinity of the oversoul. But the all-abounding absolute remains the substratum of all the individual souls. The individual souls are the creations of a sudden and spontaneous impulse and have, therefore, hardly any anticipation of their destined continuity of existence throughout the cyclic period until the final subsiding of the initial stir. Within the undifferentiated being of the absolute is born the mysterious point, the Om point, through which comes forth the variegated manyness of creation. And the vasty deep, which a fraction of a second before was icy still, is astir with the life of innumerable frothy selves who secure their separateness in definite size and shape through self-limitation within the foamy surface of the ocean. Absolute unchanged by bhas of manifestation. All this is merely an analogy. It would be a mistake to imagine that some real change takes place in the absolute when the lahar of the latent will to be conscious makes itself effective by bringing into existence the world of manifestation. There can be no act of involution or evolution within the being of the absolute, and nothing real can be born from the absolute, as any real change is necessarily a negation of the absolute. The change implied in the creation of the manifested world is not an ontological change, that is, not a change in the being of the absolute reality. It's only an apparent change. In one sense, the act of manifestation must be regarded as a sort of expansion of the illimitable being of the absolute, as through that act, the infinite, which is without consciousness, seeks to attain its own consciousness. As this expansion of reality is effected through its self-limitation in various forms of life, the act of manifestation might, with equal aptness, be called the process of timeless contraction. Whether the act of manifestation is looked upon as a sort of expansion of reality or as its timeless contraction, it is preceded by an initial urge or movement, which might, in terms of thought, be regarded as an inherent and latent desire to be conscious. I would wish to read this paragraph again. In one sense, the act of manifestation must be regarded as a sort of expansion of the illimitable being of the absolute, as through that act, the infinite, which is without consciousness, seeks to attain its own consciousness. As this expansion of reality is effected through its self-limitation in various forms of life, the act of manifestation might, with equal aptness, be called the process of timeless contraction. Whether the act of manifestation is looked upon as a sort of expansion of reality or as its timeless contraction, it is preceded by an initial urge or movement which might, in terms of thought, be regarded as an inherent and latent desire to be conscious. Okay, I need help here. I didn't understand how this is timeless contraction. So maybe we can pause and discuss, or we can come back to this later. We can come back to this later. The manifoldness of creation and the separateness of the individual souls exist only in imagination. The very existence of creation or of the world of manifestation is grounded in bhas or illusion. So that in spite of the manifestation of numberless individual souls, the oversoul remains the same without suffering any real expansion or contraction, increment or decrement. Although the oversoul undergoes no modification due to the bhas or illusion of individuation, there comes into existence its apparent differentiation into many individual souls. The most original bhas or illusion. The most original bhas or illusion into which the oversoul was allured synchronizes with the first impression. It therefore marks the beginning of the formation of samskaras. The formation of samskaras starts in the most finite center, which becomes the first focus for manifestation of the individuality of the soul. In the gross sphere, a focus of this manifestation is represented by the tridimensional and inert stone, which has the most rudimentary and partial consciousness. This vague and undeveloped state of consciousness is hardly sufficient to illumine its own shape and form, and is hopelessly inadequate to fulfill the purpose of creation, which was to enable the oversoul to know itself. Whatever little capacity for illumination consciousness has in the stone face is ultimately derived from the oversoul and not from the body of the stone. but consciousness is unable to enlarge its scope independently of the body of the stone, because the oversoul first gets identified with the consciousness and then through it with the stone form. Since all further development of consciousness is arrested by the body of the stone and its languor, evolution of higher forms or vehicles of manifestation becomes indispensable. The development of consciousness has to proceed side by side with the evolution of the body by which it is conditioned. Therefore, the will to be conscious, which is inherent in the vastness of the oversoul, seeks by divine determination a progressive evolution of the vehicles of expression. Progressive evolution of consciousness and forms. Thus, the oversoul forges for itself a new vehicle of expression in the metal form, in which consciousness becomes slightly more intensified. Even at this stage, it is very rudimentary, and so it has to get transferred to still higher forms of vegetation and trees, in which there is an appreciable advance in the development of consciousness through the maintenance of the vital processes of growth, decay, and reproduction. Emergence of a still more developed form of consciousness becomes possible when the oversoul seeks manifestation through the instinctive life of insects, birds, and animals, which are fully aware of their bodies and their respective surroundings and develop a sense of self-protection and aim at establishing mastery over their environment. Human consciousness. In the higher animals, human consciousness, the oversoul finally takes the human form, in which consciousness attains its fullest development with complete awareness of the self and the environment. At this stage, the capacity of reasoning has the widest range of activity and is unlimited in its scope. But as the oversoul gets identified through its consciousness with the gross body, consciousness does not serve the purpose of illuminating the nature of the oversoul. However, as consciousness has its fullest development in the human form, there is in it a latent potentiality for self-realization. And the will to be conscious, with which evolution started, becomes fructified in the Sadguru or man-god, who is the fairest flower of humanity. Winding of samskaras. The oversoul cannot attain self-knowledge through the ordinary consciousness of humanity because it is enveloped in a multitude of samskaras or impressions. As consciousness passes from the apparently inanimate state of stone or metal, then to the vegetative life of the trees, then onward to the instinctive states of insects, birds, and animals, and finally to the full consciousness of the human state, it is continually creating new samskaras and becoming enveloped in them. These natural samskaras are increased even after attaining the human state by further creation of non-natural samskaras through manifold experiences and multitudinous activities. Thus, the acquisition of samskaras is unceasingly going on during the process of evolution as well as during the later period of human activities. This acquisition of samskaras may be likened to the winding up of a piece of string around a stick, the string representing the samskaras and the stick representing the mind of the individual soul. The winding up starts from the beginning of creation and persists through all the evolutionary stages and the human form. And the wound string represents all the samskaras, natural as well as non-natural. Examples of potency of impressions. The fresh samskaras that are constantly being created in human life are due to the multifarious objects and ideas with which consciousness finds itself confronted. These samskaras bring about important transformations in the various states of consciousness. Impressions created by beautiful objects have the potency of arousing in consciousness the innate capacity for appreciating and enjoying beauty. When one hears a good piece of music or sees a beautiful landscape, the impressions caught from these objects gives one a feeling of exaltation. In the same way, when one contacts the personality of a thinker, one may become interested in new avenues of thought and inspired with an enthusiasm utterly foreign to one's consciousness formerly. Not only impressions of objects or persons, but also impressions of ideas and superstitions have great efficacy in determining the conditions of consciousness.
I'd like to take a pause here. I had a question.
Sure.
What is natural sanskaras and non-natural sanskaras on top of the page, winding of sanskaras?
So that's covered here. It's basically up to the human form, you get natural, and then okay. You get the non-natural samskara right here. So non-natural samskaras, wait a minute. Sanskaras that get attached to the soul during the human stage.
Are non-natural, is it?
Yeah, natural and not, yeah. So up to the human stage, you pick up natural samskaras. Mm-hmm. And from the human stage onwards, it's non-natural samskaras.
Okay.
To make another point on this, natural samskaras you are unable to so handle because it is happening through evolution. Whereas non-natural, you have a control on that. That is the
very
aspect we have to think on that. So yes. We can control that, we can reduce that. That is what is happening.
So sanskaras are attached with the form, and also in the previous pages it mentioned that when occupied with physical objects of this world, such as body, nature, and other things, the mind is, so to say, externalized and creates gross impressions. And I think impressions is exactly equal to sanskaras, or are they synonymous? Or no.
I think they are synonymous.
Synonymous, right. So we can see that external world creates gross sanskaras. But when it is busy with its own subjective mental processes, which are expressions of already existing sanskaras, it creates subtle and mental impressions. So can we say subtle and mental impressions come only after one has attained human form?
Yes, from the yes. animal onwards.
From the animal onwards.
I'm not sure about that then. You're probably right.
Yes, it's referred to earlier also.
Correct. The subtle form is existing even in the in the animal form, yeah.
I see. Okay. Yeah, I might be true, but I'm not sure. Later, Mama, you can refer me to where it was read earlier. I might have missed it. Sorry. So let's go forward. Thanks.
How are we doing on time? Yeah, so we are almost out of time. So I can take any more questions, or we can continue reading if there are no questions. I can read for another 5 minutes.
Yes.
Okay. So examples of potency of impressions. This is where I was, right? Yeah. The fresh samskaras that are constantly being created in human life are due to the multifarious objects and ideas with which consciousness finds itself confronted. These samskaras bring about important transformations in the various states of consciousness. Impressions created by beautiful objects have the potency of arousing in consciousness the innate capacity for appreciating and enjoying beauty. When one hears a good piece of music or sees a beautiful landscape, the impressions caught from these objects gives one a feeling of exaltation. In the same way, when one contacts the personality of a thinker, one may become interested in new avenues of thought and inspired with an enthusiasm utterly foreign to one's own consciousness formerly. Not only impressions of objects or persons, but also impressions of ideas and superstitions have great efficacy in determining the conditions of consciousness. The Impressions of Superstitions is the title. The power of impressions of superstitions might be illustrated by means of a ghost story.
Of consciousness.
Yeah. Of the different realms of human thought, there are perhaps none as abounding in superstitions as those connected with ghosts, who, according to popular belief, are supposed to harass and torture their victims in curious ways. Once upon a time, during the Mughal rule in India, a highly educated man who was very skeptical of the stories about ghosts made up his mind to verify them from personal experience. He had been warned against visiting a certain graveyard on the night of Amavasya, the darkest night of the month, for it was reported to be the habitation of a very dreadful ghost who unfailingly made its appearance whenever an iron nail was hammered into the ground within the limits of that graveyard. With a hammer in one hand and a nail in the other, he walked straight into the graveyard on the night of Amavasya and chose a spot bare of grass in order to drive in the nail. The ground was dark and his loosely hanging cloak was equally dark. When he sat on the ground and tried to hammer in the nail, an end of his cloak lay behind the nail and the ground and was pinned down. He finished hammering and felt that he was successful with the experiment without encountering the ghost. But as he tried to rise to leave the spot, he felt a strong pull toward the ground and he became panic-stricken. Owing to the operation of previous impressions, he could not think of anything except the ghost who he thought had caught him at last. The shock of the thought was so great that the poor man died of heart failure. This story illustrates the tremendous power that sometimes resides in the impressions created by superstition. With that, I will end today's reading. We'll continue from experience becomes harmonious when freed from samskaras. Any other points to discuss or questions? Mama, I think I would also appreciate if you could send
the chapter.
Are we that close?
It's hardly two paragraphs. Three paragraphs.
Oh, okay. Yeah, sure. Makes sense. I looked it up and I mistakenly thought it was longer. Yeah. Experience becomes harmonious when freed from samskaras. The power and effect of impressions can hardly be overestimated. An impression is solidified might and its inertness. Makes it immobile and durable. It can become so engraved upon the mind of a person that despite his sincere desire and effort to eradicate it, it takes its own time and has a way of working itself into action directly or indirectly. The mind contains many heterogeneous samskaras, and while seeking expression in consciousness, they often clash with each other. The clash of samskaras is experienced in consciousness as mental conflict. Experience is bound to be chaotic and enigmatic, full of oscillations, confusion, and complex tangles until consciousness is freed from all samskaras, good and bad. Experience can become truly harmonious and integral only when consciousness is emancipated from the impressions. Types of samskaras and states of consciousness. Samskaras can be classified according to essential differences in the nature of the spheres to which they refer. Referring to these different spheres of existence, they are found to be of three kinds. Gross samskaras, which enable the soul to experience the gross world through the gross medium and compel it to identify itself with the gross body. Subtle samskaras, which enable the soul to experience the subtle world through the subtle medium and compel the soul to identify itself with the subtle body. Mental samskaras, which enable the soul to experience the mental world through the mental medium and compel it to identify itself with the mental body. The differences between the states of the individual souls are entirely due to the differences existing in the kinds of samskaras which their consciousness is loaded. Thus, gross conscious souls experience only the gross world, subtle conscious souls experience only the subtle world, and mental conscious souls experience only the mental world. The qualitative diversity in the experience of these three types of souls is due to the difference in the nature of their samskaras. self-conscious souls free from samskaras. The self in capital. The self-conscious souls are radically different from all other souls because they experience the oversoul through the medium of the self, whereas the other souls experience only their bodies and the corresponding worlds. This radical difference between the consciousness of self-conscious souls and other souls is due to the fact that whereas the consciousness of most souls is conditioned by some kind of samskaras, the consciousness of self-conscious souls is completely free from all samskaras. It is only when consciousness is unobscured and unconditioned by any samskaras that the initial will to be conscious arrives at its final and real fruition, and the infinity and the indivisible unity of the absolute is consciously realized. The problem of deconditioning the mind through the removal of samskaras is therefore extremely important. That is the end of the chapter. Okay. Any questions and points of discussion?
So the second last sentence, it talks about individual unity of the absolute is consciously realized. Is that referring to God realization?
Yes. Yes, Ashok.
Yeah, okay, fine. Thank you.
There's a technical difference.
Yeah.
God realization is basically in terms of semantics and terminology based on God speaks. First comes nirvana, pana, annihilation of the mind, mano nash, divine absolute action, complete bliss. Self-realization, God realization defines the satchitananda, infinite knowledge, infinite power, infinite bliss. And Baba has said that between the three, knowledge, power and bliss, knowledge is the highest, self-knowledge. And if I've understood it correctly, God speaks. Baba says that as in the avatar, he only uses his infinite knowledge in the human form, whereas the Sadgurus, they use all the three. So it's a long discussion on that, but this is just a pointer that every time we get confused because of the ambiguity of the English language and the difference between how discourses and God speaks have been, you know, described. So every time you read the word self-realization, God realization, that is nirvikalpa samadhi. So what happens is because that is the real goal. And so that's my point, Jai Baba.
Thank you. Good. So I will stop this recording and then we start again. And Vidya, it's over to you.